Penguin Random House Audio presents Casey Stengel, Baseball's Greatest Character. This is the author, Marty Appel. The voice of Edna Stengel, read by Juliet Papa. Introduction. If Casey Stengel had called it a career in 1948, after winning the Pacific Coast League Championship with Oakland, he would have ridden off into the sunset with his beloved wife Edna, proudly concluding a 39-year run in pro baseball. And at 57, or 58 years old, his age was still in dispute at that time, he would have faded into that sunset and into baseball oblivion. At that point, despite the minor league pennant, he was just a .284 career platoon outfielder who had played with five National League clubs over 14 seasons, then served as a mediocre National League manager who was regularly in the second division. And let's face it, who remembers the managers of minor league champions? We fast forward to 1965, when he retired, and he is a legend, bound for the Hall of Fame. And after he won 10 pennants with the New York Yankees, and then put the New York Mets on the map as their first manager, we see how patience, knowledge, and success can come together to rewrite the ledger. Nobody ever did it quite like him. By the forceful combination of an unmatched baseball mind and an over-the-top personality, he grounded out for four decades before suddenly being recognized not only as a genius on the field, but as an American folk hero. Casey Stengel had the genius to cultivate his friendships and associations, always looking out for the next job whenever he needed one, and to get rich in the oil business while he was at it. At last, his perseverance led him to the Yankees' managerial position and five consecutive world championships. This feat is unmatched to this day. It may never be matched. When the MLB Network's Prime 9 named him baseball's greatest character in 2009, there were certainly a few generations of younger fans who were unfamiliar with him. But many more remembered him as a New York manager, and more yet, albeit in smaller numbers, still remembered his long and winding road to get there. Still, good for MLB Network, because the citation was spot on. And it awoke a lot of younger fans who were interested in just what made this character such a character. He even out-yogied his own protege, Yogi Berra, to win top honors. Yogi finished second. My friend, the late Robert Creamer, wrote a landmark book about Casey more than three decades ago, and I was fortunate this time around to have an unpublished memoir by Edna available to me, as well as access to many digitized newspapers for online research that did not exist when Bob did his research. Newspapers in Casey's small minor league towns were now available, offering newly discovered material. There was, in short, enough content to justify a new biography for this fascinating man. I hope you enjoy the splendid life of Casey Stengel, to borrow one of his favorite words. Part 1. Chapter 1. Mail Call. It was time for the mail at the Stengel home. Casey Stengel, now nearly 80, loved this time of day. He would get up to 300 letters every week, and since his home address and phone number, of course, were listed in the phone book under Stengel, Charles Casey, it was not hard to know where to send a fan letter, 1663 Grandview Avenue in Glendale, California. He and his wife Edna had lived there since her father built the place 46 years before, in 1924. People wanted his autograph, and he loved that they did. Now, in 1970, in his retirement years, the home was a splendid place to be Casey Stengel. Old friends would visit, or new ones would just ring the bell, and he would regale them with stories, jumping with ease from Babe to Joe D to Yogi to Mickey to Marvelous Marv. In his den, he would sit back in his ancient Yankee underwear — Edna was always on him to wear Mets underwear — and observe the world through 6 decades of baseball and worldly wisdom. The home sat on a quiet 2-lane street in a fashionable neighborhood near the homes of the USC baseball coach Rod Dado and Babe Herman, his old Brooklyn Dodger teammate from the 1910s. Most people thought of Casey as either a Yankee or a Met, but of course he was a baseball lifer who had played or managed almost everywhere and played with or against nearly everyone. He batted against Grover Cleveland Alexander, chased fly balls hit by Babe Ruth, sent Ron Swoboda up to pinch hit, and moved Cleon Jones to left field. His career had spanned John McGraw and Tug McGraw. Was there a ballpark he hadn't stood in? Never mind all those major league and minor league parks over more than half a century. For over 50 years, starting in 1910, the year of his first spring training, he had to check train schedules, road maps, and eventually flight schedules to get to his next training camp. In 1910 and 1911, he traveled to Excelsior Springs, Missouri. Then he went to Montgomery, Alabama, 1912, Augusta, Georgia, 1913-14, Daytona Beach, Florida, 1915-16, Hot Springs, Arkansas, 1917, Jacksonville, Florida, 1918, Birmingham, Alabama, 1920, Gainesville, Florida, 1921, San Antonio, Texas, 1922-23, Marlin, Texas, 1923, St. Petersburg, Florida, 1924-25, Jackson, Tennessee, 1926-27, Biloxi, Mississippi, 1928-29, Anniston, Alabama, 1930, Miami, Florida, 1931, Clearwater, Florida, 1932, Miami, 1933, Orlando, Florida, 1934-35, Clearwater, 1936, Bradenton, Florida, 1938-40, San Antonio, Texas, 1941, Sanford, Florida, 1942, Wallingford, Connecticut, 1943, Bartlesville, Oklahoma, 1945, Boys Hot Springs, California, 1946-47, San Fernando, California, 1948, St. Petersburg, 1949-50, Phoenix, Arizona, 1951, and St. Petersburg, 1952-60, 1962-65, and 1966-74 as a consultant. And of course, that excludes the road games and barnstorming games heading north that were part of spring training. One could learn a lot about people and a lot about America just by being Casey Stengel. And his recall. Late in life, some fan might come near the railing and say, "Casey, Casey, my dad sold you a pair of shoes in Biloxi in 1928. Casey might rub his jaw and say, "I was almost out the door and he sold me a pair of socks, too. He was a good salesman." His home was not quite a mansion, nothing you would find in Bel Air, but it was grand in the upper-middle-class neighborhood in which it stood, or splendid, as he loved to say about almost anything that got his approval. Its 4,600 square feet, a bedroom and den were added in 1937 and 1956 respectively, sat on a lot that went back from the quiet street the length of a football field, with a swimming pool, a pool house, a tennis court, and an orchard. It was a 2-story Spanish architecture stucco dwelling, described in real estate terms as Spanish eclectic with a hipped roof. There were 14 rooms, including 5 bedrooms, 1 living room with a barrel ceiling, 2 sitting rooms, maid's quarters, and 5 bathrooms on 1.25 acres. Eclectic. That was a good word for a Casey Stengel residence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.